Vasudevaya. Narayanam namaskritya naram chaiva narottamam devim sarasvatim vyasam tato jayamudirayet nashtaprayeshva badreshu nityam bhagavata sevaya bhagavatir uttamashloke bhaktir bhavati naishtiki krishnaya vasudevaya devaki nandanaya cha nandagopa kumaraya govindaya namo namaha. Reading from Srimad Bhagavad Gita, chapter 4, text number 7. The board has not yet come, but it's a very famous verse of the Bhagavad Gita, so I'll read that. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyuttanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyuttanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyuttanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyuttanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Glanir bhavati bharata abhyuttanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyuttanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Matajis, yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyuttanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata tanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. Yada yada hi dharmasya srijamyaham. Word to word translation: yada yada, whenever and wherever, he certainly, dharmasya of religion, glani, discrepancies, bhavati, become manifested, bharata, वो डिसेंडेंट ऑफ भरत अभ्युत्थानम प्रिडामिनेंस अधर्मस्य ऑफ इरिलिजन तदा एट दैट टाइम आत्मानम सेल्फ सृजामि मैनिफेस्ट अहम आई. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation: whenever and wherever
there is a decline in religious practice for descendant of Bharata and a predominant rise of irreligion, at that time I descend myself. Purport: the word Srijami is significant herein. Srijami cannot be used in the sense of creation because according to the previous verse, there is no creation of the Lord's form or body since all of the forms are eternally existent. Therefore, Srijami means that the Lord manifests himself as he is. Although the Lord appears on schedule, namely at the end of the Dwapar Yuga of the 28th millennium of the 7th Manu in one day of Brahma, he has no obligation to adhere to such rules and regulations because he is completely free to act in many ways at his will. He therefore appears by his own will whenever there is a predominance of irreligiosity and a disappearance of true religion. Principles of religion are laid down in the Vedas, and any discrepancy in the matter of properly executing the rules of the Vedas makes one irreligious. In the Bhagavatam, it is stated that such principles are the laws of the Lord. Only the Lord can manufacture a system of religion. The Vedas are also accepted as originally spoken by the Lord himself to Brahma from within his heart. Therefore, the principles of Dharma or religion are the direct orders of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. These principles are clearly indicated throughout the Bhagavad Gita. The purpose of the Vedas is to establish such principles under the order of the Supreme Lord. And the Lord directly orders at the end of the Gita that the highest principle of religion is to surrender unto him only and nothing more. The Vedic principles push one towards complete surrender unto him, and whenever such principles are disturbed by the demoniac, the Lord appears. From the Bhagavatam, we understand that Lord Buddha is the incarnation of Krishna, who appeared when materialism was rampant and materialists were using the pretext of the authority of the Vedas. Although there are certain restrictive rules and regulations regarding animal sacrifice for particular purposes in the Vedas, people of demonic tendency still took to animal sacrifice without reference to the Vedic principles. Lord Buddha appeared in order to stop this nonsense and establish the Vedic principles of non-violence. Therefore, each and every avatar or incarnation of the Lord has a particular mission, and they are all described in the revealed scriptures. No one should be accepted as an avatar unless he is referred to by scriptures. It is not a fact that the Lord appears only on Indian soil. He can manifest himself anywhere and everywhere, and whenever he desires to appear. In each and every incarnation, he speaks as much about religion as can be understood by the particular people under their particular circumstances. But the mission is the same, to lead people to God consciousness and obedience to the principles of religion. Sometimes he descends personally, and sometimes he sends his bona fide representative in the form of his son or servant or himself in some disguised form. The principles of the Bhagavad Gita were spoken to Arjun, and for that matter
to other highly elevated persons because he was highly advanced compared to ordinary persons in other parts of the world. 2 plus 2 equals 4 is a mathematical principle that is true in the beginner's arithmetic class and in the advanced class as well. Still, there are higher and lower mathematics. In all incarnations of the Lord, therefore, the same principles are taught, but they appear to be higher and lower in varied circumstances. The higher principles of religion begin with the acceptance of the four orders and the four statuses of social life, as will be explained later. The whole purpose of the mission of the incarnations is to arouse Krishna consciousness everywhere, and such consciousness is manifest and non-manifest only under different circumstances. Om Jnanati Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuron Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Tadati Sva Padantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raguna Tanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrinda Vaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripasindubhyayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Krishna I'm grateful for this opportunity to speak something on the glories of Lord Krishna, the instructions of Lord Krishna just before Janmashtami. Actually, Gaurang Prabhu was supposed to give the class, but some of his flight got delayed from out of station. So I just accepted this opportunity to speak something. So today, I just chose this verse from the Bhagavad Gita, Yada Yadahi Dharmasya Glanir Bhavati Bharata Abhyuttanam Adharmasya Tadatmanam Srijamyaham. This is one of the famous verses of the Gita, especially this verse is actually known to practically everyone, even those who may be practicing Krishna consciousness. In fact, most devotees before coming to Krishna consciousness, like one of the verses which almost everyone in India knows by seeing the Mahabharata serial is this particular verse, Yada Yada Hi Dharmasya. But sometimes this can become the most forgotten verse after coming to Krishna consciousness. So I just chose this verse. So Krishna says that
So whenever there is a decline in irreligion, I come to actually establish dharma. I appear in every millennium. Yada yadahi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyuttanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. In every millennium I appear. So such a beautiful verse. In the case of in establishing dharma in the material world, the nature of the material world is that like everything is on the decline. As the yugas proceed from Satya Yuga to Dwapara Yuga, Treta Yuga, Dwapara Yuga and Kali Yuga, everything actually goes on declining. But although usually when somebody knows that even if I do something, it is anyway going to decline, one will not have the enthusiasm to come and do that particular task. So dharma is, the nature of dharma is that, the nature of the material world is that dharma will actually keep on declining. But although Krishna knows that dharma will keep on declining, but Krishna comes again and again in every millennium to actually establish dharma. So this really requires a attitude of nishkama karma yoga, in which a person performs his duties without attachment to the results, without any personal motivation, and he just comes and performs his duties, and then again he declines, again he comes and establishes dharma. Such a beautiful verse Krishna is speaking. So today I'll speak maybe from some section from the Bhagavatam, some section from the maybe Krishna's qualities, and first I'll speak something from the Laghu Bhagavatamrita. Laghu Bhagavatamrita is a very beautiful book written by Srila Rupa Goswami, one of the primary disciples of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So this Laghu Bhagavatamrita is like a shortened version of Brihad Bhagavatamrita, which is written by Sanatan Goswami. So I'll discuss one section from Laghu Bhagavatamrita, in which Rupa Goswami describes, he establishes the position of Krishna, the Supreme Personality of God. So in this particular book, Rupa Goswami, the purpose of writing this book by Rupa Goswami is that Rupa Goswami tries to actually establish the point that among all the forms of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, how Krishna's form is the original form. It is actually the Krishna is the source of all the avatars. He actually takes different purva paksha, different arguments given by the maybe different other Vaishnavas who talk about how the different other forms of the Lord as the Supreme, but he actually takes all those purva paksha and establishes how Krishna the Supreme Lord. So I will just take one section which will actually, by that we can understand Krishna's position, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So Rupa Goswami says that the para avastha form of the Supreme Lord, para avastha means the most complete forms of the Lord, the most perfect forms of the Lord. So he says, Narsimha Ramakrishneshu Shadgunyam Paripuritam Paravastastu Tetasya Deepat Utpena Deepavat. So he explains that there are three forms of the Lord which come into the category of para avastha forms: Narsingade, Lord Ram and Krishna. So these three forms have got the six opulences in full. Shadgunyam Paripuritam. And just like one lamp is lit by another lamp, Deepat Utpena Deepavat. Similarly, all these three forms, they actually come from another form. Just like lamps, one lamp lit by another lamp, all the lamps are equally potent. That way, all these three forms are the most complete forms of God. And then he raises the question that among these three forms of God, is there any gradation? He raises this question, and then he actually goes on to explain each and every form of the Lord.
in detail. Like, for example, first he explains about the Narsingadev's appearance, Narsingadev's description. And then he describes like how Narsingadev appeared to show his mercy to Prahlad Maharaj and to kill the demon Hiranyakashipu. And then after describing Narsingadev, then he describes about Lord Ram. And he quotes various very beautiful verses from the Srimad Bhagavatam and other sources about the personality of Lord Ram. And then after describing Lord Ram, he describes about Krishna. He quotes a verse spoken by Bilwamangal Thakur. Bilwamangal Thakur says that certainly the lotus naveled Supreme Personality of Godhead has many all auspicious incarnations. But among them, who other than Krishna gives love of God even to the creepers? Even to the creepers. So Rupa Goswami gives a beautiful purport. He says, when Lord Ram was present in Ayodhya, the creepers and trees and plants of Ayodhya, they shed tears. They were shedding tears when Lord Ram was actually going from Ayodhya to the forest. But in the case of Krishna, he says that the creepers and plants and trees in Vrindavan, they were actually shedding tears every day in Vrindavan, even in the presence of Krishna. But in the case of the creepers in Ayodhya, on the imminent separation of Lord Ram, they were actually shedding tears. In that way, he highlights the how Lord Krishna bestows love of Godhead even upon the creepers and plants. So then he quotes a conversation which happened between Maitreya Rishi and Parashar Muni, and which is recorded in the Vishnu Puran. So Maitreya Rishi asks Parashar Muni that says that Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha, they were actually killed by the Supreme Lord, Narsingadev. And Ravana and Kumbhakarna, they were killed by Lord Ram. And the same personalities, Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha, they appeared as Ravana and Kumbhakarna, and they later appeared as Shishupal and Dantavakra. But when Shishupal and Dantavakra were killed by Krishna, they attained actually liberation. And but when they were killed by Narsingadev and Lord Ram, they did not attain liberation. Why is it so? So the same personalities were killed by the Supreme Lord in different forms. Hiranyakashipu and Lord Ram and Krishna, they are not different from each other. Just like a Vaidurya gem, it has got a different facets. Sometimes if you turn in a particular direction, it manifests certain color. If you turn in a different direction, it manifests other color. But actually, it is the same gem. So similarly, the same personality, Krishna, he takes different forms. And they have killed the same demons who have appeared in different forms. But why is it that only on being killed by Krishna that they attained salvation? So Parashar Muni answers this question. So in essence, he says, in the case of Hiranyakashipu, when Narsingadev appeared, Hiranyakashipu did not realize that Narsingadev was Vishnu, or Narsingadev was the Supreme Personality of God. So Hiranyakashipu thought that, so this particular creature, this particular person, Narsingadev, is some extraordinary living entity with a great pious credits, this living entity has taken this particular form. So that was his thought. And Hiranyakashipu, he was actually very strongly influenced by the mode of passion. Because of that, he could not actually focus his attention completely on the form of the Lord. He was focusing on the form of the Lord. He was hating the Narsing ಆಗದೆ ಬಟ್ ದನ್ ದಟ್ ಹೇಟ್ರೆಡ್ ವಾಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅಕಂಪನಿಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಅಬ್ಸಾರ್ಬ್ಷನ್
ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಕೇಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಹಿರಣ್ಯಕಶಿಪು ಹಿ ಡಿಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ರಿಯಲೈಸ್ ದಟ್ ನರಸಿಂಹದೇವ್ ವಾಸ್ ವಿಷ್ಣು ಹಿ ಥಾಟ್ ದಟ್ ಹೀಸ್ ಅ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾಡಿನರಿ ಲಿವಿಂಗ್ ಎಂಟಿಟಿ ವಿತ್ ಹೂ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಗಾಟ್ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಪೈಯಸ್ ಕ್ರೆಡಿಟ್ಸ್ ಸೊ ರೂಪಕೋಸ್ವಾಮಿ ಸೇಸ್ ದಟ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಹಿರಣ್ಯಕಶಿಪು ಬಿವಿಲ್ಡರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ His mind did not actually take shelter, of the Supreme Personality of God, and his mind did not unite with the Supreme Personality of God. And he says there are two conditions in which the mind is actually completely connected to the Supreme Lord. One is that when the mind is convinced that he is the absolute truth. And secondly, when a person becomes extremely hateful towards him, then the mind is completely focused on the Supreme Lord. So in the case of Hiranyakashipu, he is not convinced that he is the Supreme Lord, and he had hatred towards Narasingade, but then that hatred was not accompanied with absorption. So without accepting the personality of Godhead as the exclusive resort of the mind, he could not actually attain liberation. But because he was killed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, because usually a demon like Vena, he attained hell. But in the case of Hiranyakashipu, because he was killed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he attained wealth and power which was not reachable, which was wealth and power beyond even the devatas. And then that Hiranyakashipu, he was born as Ravana. So in the case of Ravana, Parashurmani goes on to explain, Ravana, he also had great hatred towards Lord Ram, but because his mind was lustful, he had a great lust towards Mother Sita. So because of the lust towards Sita, he failed to become attracted towards Lord Ram. He also considered Lord Ram to be a human, and he failed to recognize that Lord Ram is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, because his mind was diverted, or his mind was obsessed with lusty thoughts towards enjoying Mother Sita. And therefore, Ravana, his hatred towards Lord Ram was also not accompanied with complete absorption. And therefore, on being killed by Lord Ram, he did not attain the highest liberation. On the other hand, he also took birth as a great king, Sishupal, with great opulences. With great opulences, being killed by the Supreme Lord, therefore he didn't attain the hell. He was born with a great king with a great opulences. And Sishupal, in the case of, he was born as Sishupal, but in the case of Sishupal, he was actually constantly chanting the holy names of Krishna, and his mind was always filled with the form of Krishna. So Rupa Goswami says that in the case of Krishna, Krishna constantly manifests the specific potency of enchantment that leads to liberation. Compared to the other forms of Narasingadeva and Lord Ram, Krishna constantly manifests the specific potency of enchantment that leads to liberation. And this specific potency of enchantment, it appears in two principal ways. One is through the charm of his holy names, and second is through the beauty of his form. So Sishupal, because he was chanting the names of Krishna out of hatred, right from the beginning, because he was constantly chanting the holy names of Krishna, that by the power of chanting the holy names, he actually became aware that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of God. And his mind became completely fixed on the form of Krishna. So therefore Rupa Goswami basically points out that in the case of Hiranyakashipu and Ravana, that although they had hatred, but that hatred was not accompanied by absorption. They didn't have intense hatred, but being killed by the Lord, they didn't attain liberation, but they attained actually great opulences. But in the case of Shishupal, he remained wrapped in thought of Krishna. And his absorption in Krishna, it reached the highest pinnacle in the Rajasya sacrifice. Like usually, Krishna had given a benediction that that as long as Shishupal does not exceed 99 blasphemies, I will not kill him. Whenever he exceeds 99, I will actually kill him. So Shishupal was blaspheming Krishna right from the beginning of his birth. But every time he would blaspheme Krishna, he would count, and when it comes to 99, he would stop. So one class, Isolnath Radhanath Maharaj was explaining that, but Shishupal's, he had that envy towards Krishna, but his envy towards Krishna got slightly diverted when he was about to get married to Rukmini. So the attraction towards, because the attraction towards Rukmini, the envy towards Krishna got slightly sidelined. But then when Krishna came and kidnapped Rukmini at the last moment, when he thought that he was going to get married to Rukmini, and then when Krishna defeated all the kings, then Shishupal's envy at that point, it increased hundreds of times more. Right? Which was slightly subdued, it actually bounced back. Just like some devotee sometimes he commits some mistakes, but then a sincere devotee, he again bounces back. Brahmaji in the Brahma Vimohan Leela, yeah, he committed a mistake, he tried to exercise his power over Krishna. But the beauty of the great devotees is that, it's not that they don't commit mistakes. Their greatness is that how they actually bounce back after they commit their mistakes. So how Brahmaji realized his mistake, how he offered such beautiful prayers, one of the longest prayers in the Bhagavatam. His devotion became even more intense in those 40 prayers, which Vishnu Chakravartakur says that, may these prayers of Lord Brahma become the foundation of my consciousness. So similarly here, on the other side here, Shishupal, his envy got a little bit subdued because of attraction towards Rukmini, but that envy, it bounced back with a greater intensity when Krishna kidnapped Rukmini and went away. And that envy towards Krishna, it actually increased hundreds and thousands of millions of times more in the Rajasya sacrifice, when Krishna was chosen as was the person who should be worshipped for the Agra Puja. So then at that time, he became so much absorbed that the sign of absorption is that a person actually fails to keep track of the time. He fails to keep track of the number of rounds he is chanting. So in the case of, at this instance, Shishupal, he became so absorbed, he actually didn't realize that that I have to count the number of blasphemies. So that is why one class Maharaj explained that Shishupal's envy towards Krishna is as incomprehensible as Gopi's love towards Krishna. So his absorption and envy, that absorption is just like one devotee gave the example in the olden days that when they would want to actually store some treasure, some gold and silver, different treasure in the house, they would actually put the treasure in the ceiling of the house. And then they would cover the ceiling with a wax. With the wax, they would actually melt the wax and then they would actually cover the ceiling. And then there would be different valuables, maybe some gold, some silver, some diamond, or so different other valuables. So in order to identify which item is kept in actually different places of the ceiling, they would actually they would color the wax with the different colors, and then they would cover different parts of the ceiling with a different colored wax. But in order to color the wax, when the wax is melted, at that time you have to add the color, and then so maybe red color would be added, and then blue color will be added, and then that melted wax added with the color, that would be actually used to cover the ceiling. But once the color is added to the melted wax, if you want to remove the color, you can't actually remove the color, because the color has entered each and every particle of the wax. Each and every minute particle of the wax, the color has entered, so you can't actually separate that color from the melted wax. Like sometimes some color has come into the cloth, or we use some chemical to actually remove that color. But in the melted wax, when you add the color, it's not possible to remove the color. So similarly, in the case of Shishupal and the gopis, Krishna had entered each and every particle of their consciousness, that they became so much absorbed that that is why it is on the higher, that you can't actually remove Krishna from their consciousness. That's why Narada Muni came and asked gopis that, what are you doing? Why are you meditating? They said that, we are trying to remove Krishna from our consciousness, but we are not unable to do that. So when Shishupal, because he remained wrapped in thought of Krishna, and when on being killed by Krishna, he attained liberation. So therefore, Rupa Goswami says that Rupa Goswami is quoting this section from the Vishnu Puran to show that among the three Paravastha forms, Narsingadev, Lord Ram and Krishna, Krishna constantly manifests the specific potency of enchantment that leads to liberation. Therefore, he attracted the mind of Shishupal so much, and his holy names and his form was so attractive, that Shishupal, he became so much wrapped in thought of Krishna that on being killed by Krishna, attained liberation. So, yeah, when we talk about the different forms of the Lord, yeah, from a tattva point of view, there is no difference between the different forms. Rupa Goswami says that Anya Bilashita Shunyam Jnana Karmadi Anavritam Anukulyena Krishnanu Shilanam. So devotional service is for Krishna. It means that Krishna includes all his incarnations, the Vishnu tattvas, and all his devotees, the spiritual master, the abode of the Lord. But still, he could have used any other word like Narsimha Anushilanam or Vaman Anushilanam or Parashuram Anushilanam, like that. But he specifically uses the word Krishna. So by that, he also wants to highlight the superiority of devotion to this form of Krishna. So this shows how Rupa Goswami, by using the word Krishna Anushilanam, is accommodating the devotion towards all forms of Godhead. But and at the same time, in accommodating, is also highlighting the form of the highlighting the devotion to the Supreme Personality of Godhead in its original form. That is the beauty of the acharyas, how they actually highlight the essence at that same time, actually accommodating all forms of devotion to the various forms of God. although there is a gradation in the forms of God, but sometimes the devotees, sometimes the devotees may be quarreling or may be fighting with maybe devotees from other sampradayas. We think, this form of Godhead is superior, they may quarrel on the Madhurya is superior, Dasya is inferior, like that. Sometimes they quarrel, but it is like, it's like saying that suppose like the two people are quarreling. One person is saying that Mysore Pak is the best of the sweets. So another person is saying that no, Son Papadi is the best of the sweets. and they are, each of them, they are quarreling and they are giving different reasons. And outside the door, some thousands of people are starving because of rice and dal. So the thousands of people are starving for rice and dal, and then they are completely oblivious to the fact that maybe devotees are quarreling, oh, which sweet is superior, Mysore Pak or Son Papdi. So similarly, sometimes devotees quarrel with other Vaishnavas, so which form is superior, and when millions of Jivatmas are suffering, they are not even, they are struggling to come out of their bodily platform to the basic human platform. So the purpose is not to, the purpose of this narration is not to to understand the supreme form of Krishna, but not to use this to actually maybe quarrel with the other Vaishnavas, so your form of devotion is inferior or something like that, but to actually understand the supreme form of Krishna. So that is why Rupa Bhaktivinoda Thakur, when he talks about the anarthas represented by forest fire, one of the anarthas he says is that forest fire represents the conflict among the sampradayas, which could be based on maybe some rasa or different, like the forms of God, etc. So therefore, we have to be aware of these anarthas, but at the same time, we have to understand the like this truth which are presented by our acharyas in the different books. And in fact, Rupa Goswami, just to highlight the same point, he also quotes a verse from the Gita. In the Gita, he quotes a verse from the 16th chapter. So this verse, apparently externally, if you see, this verse may talk about the concept of eternal hell. So if you see, in the Vedic scriptures, one of the difference between the Vedic scriptures and maybe the faith in some other religions or other scriptures, so there are other religions which talk about the concept of eternal hell. But in the Vedic scriptures, there is no concept of eternal hell. But there are two sections in the Gita which appear to give an idea of eternal hell. So one section is from the first chapter of the Gita, where Arjuna says that narakam niyate vaso bhavati anushushruma. He says that those people who actually destroy the family tradition, I have heard that such people will reside in hell eternally. So actually, when you talk about the concept of eternal hell, it is, you can't literally take this narakam niyate vaso, because the Gita Krishna says that the whole material world is temporary and hell is part of the material world. So how can there be eternal hell? So therefore, when Arjuna is saying narakam niyate, you should not take literally. Here Arjuna is trying to highlight the gravity of the sin of those who destroy the family tradition, the family tradition of offering pindadan, shraddha and the different pindadan to the forefathers. This is such a grave sin that those who become responsible for that sin, they actually go to hell eternally. So it is like the scriptures use the word atmaha, killer of the soul. So again, soul is actually eternal, so you cannot take literally, but it is just talking about the killer of the soul. Similarly, so another verse in the Gita, which may also appear to talk about the concept of eternal hell, the 16th chapter of the Gita, where Krishna says, Tanyaham dvishata kruran samsareshu naradaman kshipam ajasram ashuban asurisyeva yonishu. And then he says, Asurim yoni mapanna muda janmani janmani mam aprapyaiva kaunteya tato yanti adamam gatim. So especially this particular verse, Krishna is saying that tanyakam dushatak kururan, I actually cast the those who are demoniac people, Dushatana, the envious demoniac people, samsareshu naradaman, such people actually rot in the material existence, they actually take birth as the lowest of human beings. Kripam asurim yonim apanna, and taking birth in the demoniac species, birth after birth, muda janmani janmani, birth after birth, mam apraapyaiva kaunteya, not attaining me, tato yanti adamam gatim, they glide down to the adamam gatim, the lowest state of existence. So if we see this verse, it appears that they will actually, these demoniac people, because 16th chapter talks about divine and demoniac nature, like Krishna is saying the destination of demoniac people is that they will birth after birth, they will take upon the demoniac species and then they will glide down to the lowest species. It appears that it is also in line with the concept of the eternal hill. There is there is no chance for them to again come back. It appears like that. But the acharyas highlight this word here, mam apraapyaiva kaunteya. Mam apraapyaiva kaunteya means not attaining me. That means Krishna is saying that these demons, when they do not attain me, when they don't killed by me, there is no hope for them. So when they get killed by my hands, then they attain liberation. So Rupa Goswami quotes this verse to show that that those demons who are actually killed by even the other forms of God, they don't attain the ultimate liberation. Yeah, they may attain, yeah, one of the quality of Krishna is that hatari gati dayaka, but the other forms of God, when they kill the demons, just like Hiranyakashipu and Ravana, they did not attain liberation, but they were liberated from their sins. That is, we can say that is one level of liberation. They again took birth as a great kings. But when the demons, when they get killed by Krishna, they actually attain the highest liberation. So Rupa Goswami quotes this particular verse also to show that the special form of the special nature of the Swayam Rupa form, the original Supreme Personality of God. So, I will take another verse from the Srimad Bhagavatam 10th canto in the section of the appearance of Krishna. So, this verse says, Sa Devaki Sarva Jagan Nivasa Nivasa Bhuta Nitaram Nareje Bojendra Gehegni Shikeva Rudda Saraswati Jnana Kale Yatasati. So this verse says, when Krishna Sa Devaki Sarva Jagannivasa, Sarva Jagannivasa, Krishna, who is the shelter of the entire universe, the entire cosmic manifestation, when he entered the womb of Mother Devaki, when Mother Devaki, Sa Devaki Sarva Jagannivasa, Nivasa Bhuta, so that Krishna, who is the shelter of the entire universe, took shelter of the womb of Mother Devaki, Nivasa Bhuta. Nitaramna Reje, Bojendra Gehegni Shikeva Rudda. So, that Krishna, when he took shelter of the womb of Devaki, it appeared like a flame which was covered within a pot. Bojendra Gehe means the Krishna was actually confined within the prison cell of the Kamsa. Bojendra refers to Kamsa. So Krishna was confined within the prison cell of Kamsa. And this confinement of Krishna within the prison cell of Kamsa, it is compared to the analogy, compared to two analogies, just like a fire is confined within the pot. Or a person who has knowledge but does not distribute that knowledge. Saraswati Jnana Kale Yatasati. He keeps the knowledge locked within himself. So, Prabhupada writes such a brilliant purport here. He says that the knowledge has to be, knowledge should not be kept confined, it has to be distributed. So the reason why there are problems all over the world is that the India which has the spiritual knowledge, the Indians which have, who have the spiritual knowledge, they failed to distribute that knowledge everywhere. So that is why there is problem all over the world. So just like when we talk about the Kamsa, like one is the person Kamsa, another is the concept represented by Kamsa. So Kamsa was a historical personality, but the concept or the principle represented by Kamsa is that Kamsa was trying to confine Krishna within the prison cell. But the very nature of Krishna is that Krishna is all pervading. So that is the very nature of Krishna. So one who confines the all pervading Krishna within a particular place, so that person is contaminated by the attitude of Kamsa. So that attitude is represented by Kamsa. So therefore, we have to understand this point that Prabhupada tells in another class that the Krishna, the very nature of Krishna is all pervading, and that this Krishna has appeared in the form of the Krishna consciousness movement, and that Krishna consciousness movement should also be all pervading, and it should actually enter into all the fields, including politics and like that. He gives a list, science and different fields he explains, because that is the core nature of Krishna, which you cannot confine that. And one who tries to confine Krishna to the particular field, that person is contaminated with the attitude of Kamsa. And just like, because Kamsa tried to confine Krishna, he got destroyed. So similarly, those who try to confine Krishna within a particular this one, they will eventually get destroyed. So just building upon the same point, the Chatushloki Srimad Bhagavatam, the last Chatushloki, Krishna is telling to Brahmaji, Etavat eva jigyasyam tatva jigyasunatmana anvaya vyatirekabhyam yatsyat sarvatra sarvada. So Krishna is telling to Brahmaji that one who tries to inquire, the inquiries should culminate to the inquiry of how to develop love for the Supreme Lord. One should, like the different people inquire about different subject matters. Prabhupada has written such a brilliant purport. People inquire about different subject matters. So, like usually, the nature of a human being is to inquire, but that depending on the culture in which a person is exposed to, the inquiries become focused on a different subject matter. So in a materialistic culture, in a material culture, the inquiries becomes focused on just eating, mating, sleeping and defending. So that becomes the focus. But when in a spiritual culture, the inquiries, a person starts focusing on the higher truths, a person starts focusing on what is the purpose of life, and then when the inquiry is further, when they keep on actually, when the person progresses in his inquiry, the inquiry reaches the ultimate culmination of how to develop love for the Supreme Lord. Tatva jigyasunatmana. And we see in the Ramananda Samvad, the inquiry of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, it kept on progressing, it went to the highest pinnacle of all the inquiries, it led to the glories of Srimati Radharani. So here, so Krishna is telling to Brahmaji that in order to obtain love for the Supreme Lord, one has to perform sadhana bhakti, and this anvaya vyatirekabhyam yatsyat sarvatra sarvada, and this sadhana bhakti, this process of bhakti can be performed in all time, place and circumstances. And one should inquire about this process of sadhana bhakti both directly and indirectly. Both directly and indirectly. So he says, this particular purport, just to trying to understand this fundamental principle of the all pervading nature of Krishna, just like Krishna is all pervading, this verse establishes the point that bhakti to Krishna is also all pervading. Our devotion to Krishna is also all pervading. That's what it means, yatsya sarvatra sarvada. And so the attitude of Kamsa is that Kamsa tries to restrict Krishna consciousness. So when we try to restrict Krishna, sometimes that attitude comes in different ways, in the form of they say that bhakti can be performed only by those who are pure. Or somebody may say bhakti can be practiced only in a particular ashram. Or somebody may say, in the grahastha ashram I have so many responsibilities, I can't practice bhakti. Or sometimes one may say like that, they restrict bhakti to a particular ashram. Or sometimes a person may restrict bhakti because I have many desires, many material desires, so therefore I can't practice bhakti. Or somebody may say they may restrict bhakti only to the old age. Only in old age bhakti can be practiced only in the old age. They may restrict bhakti only to hearing and chanting. Or some people may restrict bhakti only people from born in a high family, Brahminical family, only they can practice bhakti. Or some people restrict bhakti only to the particular people born in a particular caste. Or sometimes they say, like Prabhupada would say that Jagannath means he's the Lord of the universe, don't make him actually Oriyanath. like this attitude of restricting bhakti to a particular section, a particular group, so that attitude is actually Kamsa. But Jiva Goswami in that purport to this verse, Prabhupada is writing elaborate purport, he quotes from different sources how the bhakti to Krishna is all pervading. It can be practiced irrespective of the birth, irrespective of one's purity. A person with material desires can practice bhakti, a person without material desires can practice bhakti, and bhakti can be performed in all the stages of life, right from the womb to tomb, and bhakti can be performed in all the ages, and bhakti can be performed using all activities. Yat karoshi yadashnasi yat juhoshi dadasi yat yat tapasyati kaunte tatkurushva madarpanam. He quotes this verse. Once one devotee approached Prabhupada that he's saying that I am very much addicted to drinking wine. So Prabhupada said, okay, wine cannot be offered to Krishna, but even in a wine there is certain percentage of distilled water. So before drinking wine, you offer that portion of the distilled water to Krishna, and then you drink the wine. So in that sense, so then that person, like after some time, he gave up the drinking wine by following Prabhupada's instruction. So the point is that even bhakti can be performed even with any types of ingredients which can be easily available everywhere. Patram pushpam phalam toyam yome bhaktiya prayachati. So in this way, we find that this particular verse says that how the bhakti is all pervading. Krishna is all pervading, and similarly bhakti is also all pervading. So although the bhakti is all pervading, it is universal, but it also has a specific nature. It also has a specific aspect. That means that bhakti is only for Krishna or his different forms. Bhakti is not for any devatas, or bhakti, you can't say that like Manav Seva is equal to Madhav Seva, service to humanity is also service to the Lord. No, the philanthropy can be performed in devotion to Krishna. It can be detailed in the service of Krishna in the devotional mood one can perform, but you can't equate philanthropy. Manav Seva is equal to Madhav Seva, that cannot do. So just like bhakti is universal, but it also has a specific aspect. That there are certain particular rules and regulation. Shruti, Smriti, Purana, Adi, Pancharatrika, Vidim, Vina, Aikantiki, Harer, Bhakti, Utpata, Eva, Kalpate. We chant the mantras given in the scriptures. There are some specific rules and regulations. So therefore, bhakti is all pervading, it is universal and also specific. So that is the principle of Bhagavad Dharma. So we find many people, they speak about universal concepts. So those who speak about universal concepts, but without the specific nature, without some specific, without the specific nature of the Bhagavad Dharma, because it is like exam. For example, people say that yato mat tato pad. You follow any path, you will reach the, ultimately the same perfection. You worship any god, you will ultimately it's all the same. Or you meditate on any particular thing. So in that way, they speak about in a universal concept, but without that specific nature of highlighting the specific nature of bhakti to Krishna or bhakti to some form of Krishna, etc. So such kind of universal concept, it lacks the substance. It is very superficial. And there are other people, they understand the specific nature of Bhagavad, they practice the specific Bhagavad Dharma, bhakti to Krishna, but they fail to understand the universal nature of that, the Bhagavad Dharma. So those who fail to understand the universal nature of that Bhagavad Dharma, which is for Krishna, they become sectarian and arrogant. So therefore, I always mentioned that when Prabhupada established the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, so some devotees said, you either name International Society for God Consciousness or you just name Society for Krishna Consciousness. Because Krishna means is very specific, then why are you making it international? And if you want to establish an international society, then use a generic name as God Consciousness, which will appeal to everyone. But Prabhupada, he had the conviction, the specific nature of Krishna Consciousness, it is actually universal. So therefore, he said, no, it has to be International Society for Krishna Consciousness. So therefore, this has to be understood that the universal nature or the all-pervading nature of Krishna and the Bhagavad Dharma, the Krishna Consciousness, and Kamsa is that person who restricts this Krishna Consciousness to which is all pervading to a particular maybe activity or particular thing. So Jiva Goswami says that he does a grammatical analysis. He says in any activity there are six things involved: the subject of an activity, the object of an activity, the instrument to perform that activity, the location. I'll give an example. So he says that in an activity, the six things are involved, but in the activity of bhakti, all the six things actually attained all auspiciousness. But when a person practices some other activity which does not have bhakti in it, it does not produce auspiciousness. It will produce inauspiciousness to some people. So he says that in the case of bhakti, for example, subject of an activity, Prahlad performed bhakti. Here Prahlad is the subject. So Prahlad attained auspiciousness by performing bhakti to Krishna. And Indra offered Surabhi cow to Krishna. So here Surabhi cow is an object in the activity of bhakti. And this Surabhi cow, the object attained auspiciousness because of connection to bhakti. And instrument, Rukmini sent a letter through the Brahmana to Krishna. So the Brahmana acted as an instrument in the activity of bhakti. So that Brahmana attained auspiciousness because of connection to bhakti, although he was just an instrument. And location of an activity, whichever place where bhakti is performed, and that location becomes all auspicious. Like few years back, some devotees, they were planning to go on a pilgrimage tour to America. So they wonder like, how can he? Usually the scriptures say that the more you go towards the western direction, the materialism becomes more and more rampant. So they wonder how are they going on a, I'm not specifically against America or something, but it's a fact that the materialism is more and more rampant. but the devotees are going on a pilgrimage tour to those places where Prabhupada had spent the 26th Second Avenue. They wanted to visit those places. So wherever the places where the bhakti is performed, that location becomes all auspicious. And then the fifth is the receiver of an action of bhakti. Govardhan gave so many facilities, so many offerings, so many facilities like caves and nice water and trees and fruits to the residents of Vrindavan for the pleasure of Krishna. In this, the Vrajavasis were the receiver of the activity of bhakti, but they attained all auspiciousness. And the source of separation, the sixth source of separation, like cow gives, the milk from the cow was given to Krishna. So the milk was separated from the cow. The cow becomes the source of separation of the milk. Usually when something is taken away from the person, when you give some, say, money or some possession to others, you lose that, you lose that facility or comfort. But when you give something to Krishna, the source of separation becomes all auspicious. So in this way, Jiva Goswami says that in the action of bhakti, all these six things, subject, object, instrument, location, the source of separation, the receiver of an action, all these things achieve auspiciousness. Whereas in the other processes, jnana, karma, or any materialistic activity, something may achieve auspiciousness temporarily, some other object may not attain auspiciousness. So therefore, so the point is that we want to highlight the all-pervading nature of bhakti and the attitude of Kamsa. Just a few more points about the case of Jarasandha, Krishna dealing with Jarasandha and Akrura. We will just take one comparison. In the case of Jarasandha, when Krishna came to Mathura, so Krishna actually showed his mercy to Kubja, Krishna straightened Kubja, and Akrura and Kubja, both of them invited Krishna to their home. But Krishna, Krishna told them, no, I will come later. So, because Krishna, he was focused on the mission of killing Kamsa. So therefore he said that, although the devotees called him with great affection, but he said, I will come later. So Krishna did not allow his affection towards the devotees in actually, Krishna did not allow his affection towards the devotees in actually distracting him from the mission of establishing dharma, which involves actually killing a personality like Kamsa. And in the Jarasandha's episode, when Jarasandha accumulated 23 Akshauhini divisions of soldiers, so Krishna was thinking, oh, what should I do in this situation? So Jarasandha, because he had great enmity and hatred, and he came to kill Krishna, accumulating 23 Akshauhini divisions of soldiers. But Krishna decided, oh, I will kill everyone except Jarasandha. Because he felt, Jarasandha is having great enthusiasm to bring together so many demonic population, so I can use him as an instrument in the establishment of dharma. So Krishna did not allow any personal hatred towards Jarasandha in diverting him in his mission of establishing dharma. So that is how Krishna actually reconciles, that's why we quoted this verse, yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata. Krishna was focused in his mission of establishing dharma. And we can see another beautiful point from Jarasandha's episode. So Krishna, Jarasandha was being used by Krishna in establishing dharma. Jarasandha unconsciously became an instrument in the hands of Krishna in the establishment of dharma. But Arjuna consciously became an instrument in the hands of Krishna to establish dharma. So, like sometimes, expert devotee of Krishna may utilize somebody who may have great enthusiasm, not for serving Krishna, may have great enthusiasm for some material principle, but an expert devotee of Krishna can dotail that enthusiasm of that particular person in the Krishna's cause of establishing dharma. Just like Krishna dotailed that Jarasandha's enthusiasm to accumulate so many demons in the cause of establishing dharma. So again, in that episode we find another comparison. In the Vrindavan, when the Vrajavasis saw that so many demons were actually coming to attack Krishna, so all the Vrajavasis had a meeting. So that is one management meeting where unanimously all the people involved in the meeting, they actually came to the conclusion that, oh, we should actually move from Gokul Mahavan to actually Vrindavan for the safety of Krishna. So all the Vrajavasis, for the safety of Krishna, they decided to move from Gokul Mahavan to Vrindavan. It's a big decision, and they actually came, that's what the will of Krishna, they came to that conclusion. But in when Jarasandha attacked, when Jarasandha and Kalaivan attacked simultaneously, Krishna, for the safety of the Mathura Vasis, he transferred the Mathura Vasis overnight from Mathura to Dwaraka after building Dwaraka. So here we see that how the devotees, for the sake of Krishna's protection, they shifted from one place to another place. And Krishna, for the sake of the devotees, how he actually built Dwaraka and he transferred them. And lastly, we find in the, again, the Putana episode, this is a, we may not have time to go into this episode, but we highlight one point. So Swami speaks, he starts telling that Kamsa actually appointed Putana to kill all the newborn babies. So then at that time, Shukadeva Goswami speaks a verse, Nayatra Shravanadini Raksho Gnaniswa Karmasu Kurvanti Satvatam Bartum Yatu Danyasya Tatrahi. So he says that wherever there is hearing and chanting the glories of Krishna, there cannot be any danger in the circumstance. So this particular verse, apparently he starts the pastime and then he speaks a verse, it does not seem to be actually in line with the flow of the pastime. But why he speaks this verse is that, he says that, because Parishit Maharaj becomes anxious, oh, Putana has come to kill Krishna, what is going to happen to Krishna? So he becomes anxious. The same Parishit Maharaj, in the beginning of the Bhagavatam, in the beginning of the second canto, he was actually fearful. So at that time, Shukadeva Goswami speaks the verse, Tasmat Bharata Sarvatma Bhagavan Ishwaro Hari Shrotavya Kirtitavyascha Smartavyascha Ichyata Bhayam. Says that if you want to be freed from fear, one should hear, chant and remember the Supreme Lord. So this particular verse is quoted by Rupa Goswami for, as an example for Vaidhi Sadhana Bhakti, because in this verse it is said that if a person wants to be freed from fear, one should follow bhakti according to the instructions of the scriptures, which says that bhakti actually extinguishes the fear of samsara. So in the beginning of the Bhagavatam, Parishit Maharaj was fearful of the death. That is why Shukadeva Goswami is speaking this verse. If you want to be freed from fear, take shelter of hearing, chanting and remembering. But now in the 10th canto, Parishit Maharaj has come to the level of being fearful for Krishna's safety. So that is how the Bhagavatam elevates a person from the platform of fear to the love for Krishna. So Parishit Maharaj becomes fearful when he hears that, oh, Kamsa has sent Putana to kill Krishna. So then Shukadeva Goswami says that wherever there is hearing and chanting of Krishna's holy names, there cannot be any danger. So where Krishna is personally present, how can there be any danger? How can there be any danger? So in this way, Shukadeva Goswami begins his pastime, and so to summarize, we talked about what the first thing we talked about. So we talked about the establishment of Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, from the Laghu Bhagavatamrita, our Rupa Goswami says that among the three Paravastha forms, Narasingha, Ram and Krishna, Krishna the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And then we discussed that how the all-pervading nature of Krishna, and just like Krishna is all-pervading, bhakti to Krishna is also all-pervading. And Kamsa represents the principle of one who tries to restrict Krishna, or one who tries to restrict bhakti only to a certain way, a certain this thing. And then we discussed the point of how Krishna's dealing with Jarasandha, how he did not get diverted in his mission of establishing dharma by his affection towards his devotees or his hatred towards the demons. And how the devotees protected for Krishna's safety, they actually shifted from Gokul Mahavan to Vrindavan. And similarly, Krishna, for the safety of the Mathura Vasis, he actually shifted from Mathura to Dwaraka. And we discussed finally about the how Parishit Maharaj, he actually was elevated in hearing Srimad Bhagavatam from the platform of fear to the love for Krishna. From anxiety out of anxiety of fear of death to anxiety for the safety of Krishna. And in this way, we find that wherever there is hearing and chanting of Krishna, there cannot be any danger. So I'll stop here. Grantana Srimad Bhagavatam ki chai, Srila Prabhupada ki chai, Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki chai.